Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. If you have a cell phone, I would really like you to turn it on silent mode, please. Ladies and gentlemen, the Snowbird travelers have arrived in our little town of Osoyoos. They have so graciously offered their talents for our entertainment tonight. Please be patient as we change the settings for the next performance. So without further ado, let me introduce you to music that warms the soul. We have well-known artists sharing their musical talents, touching our hearts with their song from way down under.
Oh, yeah.
thank you so much, boys.
You didn't say no telling.
There was this guy at the bar, just looking at his drink. He stays like this for a half an hour. And then a big troublemaking truck driver steps up next to him, takes the drink from him and just downs it. The poor man just started crying. The truck driver says, "Oh, come on, man. I was just joking. Here, I'll buy you another drink." The man replies, wiping his tears, "This has been the worst day of my life. First, I overslept. Got to the office. My boss was outraged and he fired me. When I leave the building, my car had been stolen. The police said there wasn't anything they could do about it. I got a cab. When I got out of the cab drove away with my wallet in it. I realized I left it. Oh well. I went inside to my house to find my wife in bed with a gardener. I leave home, go to this bar, sit here thinking about ending my life. Just when I was about to do that, you came and drank my poison." Stories must be told of days gone by, of events, of promises that have affected our very being. Please welcome a true friend that never wavers and never strays. Don't lose all that gold, boy. Well, I think he wants to give it to me.
Too much gold.
Clean it on the fireplace.
I just know you wanted to share that gold.
Good evening. Good evening. I'd like to do for you a little poem that I learned a long time ago. To quote Billy Joel, "It's sad and it's sweet, and I knew it complete when I wore a younger man's clothes." So bear with me. "There are strange things done in the midnight sun by the men who moil for gold. The Arctic trails have their secret tales that would make your blood run cold. The northern lights have seen queer sights, but the queerest they ever did see was that night on the marge of Lake LaBarge that cremated Sam McGee." Now Sam McGee was from Tennessee, where the cotton blooms and blows. Why he left his home in the south to roam around the pole, God only knows. He was always cold. But the land of gold seemed to hold him like a spell, though he'd often say in his homely way, "I'd sooner live in hell." On a Christmas day, we were mushing our way over the Dawson Trail. Talk about cold, oh. Our parka's fold is stabbed like a driven nail. If our eyes we closed, the lashes froze till sometimes we couldn't see. It wasn't much fun, but the only one to whimper was Sam McGee. And that very night, as we lay packed tight in our robes beneath the snow, the dogs were fed and the stars overhead were dancing heel and toe, he turns to me, "Cap," says he, "I'll cash in this trip, I guess. And if I do, I'm asking you not to refuse my last request." Well, he seemed so low, I couldn't say no. And he said with sort of a moan, "'Tis this cursed cold, It's got hold till I'm chilled through to the bone. It ain't being dead, it's the awful dread of an icy grave that pains. So I want you to swear that foul or fair, you'll cremate my last remains. Well, a pal's last need is a thing to heed, so I swore I would not fail. We started out at the streak of dawn. God, he looked ghastly pale. He crouched on the sleigh and he raved all day of his home in Tennessee. And by nightfall, a corpse was all that was left of Sam McGee. Well, there wasn't a breath in that land of death, and I hurried on, horror-driven, with a corpse half-hid that I couldn't get rid because of a promise given. It was lashed to the sleigh, and it seemed to say, you may tax your brain and bronze, your brawn and brains, but you promised true, and it's up to you to cremate those last remains. Now, a promise made is a debt unpaid, and the trail has its own stern code. In the days to come, though my lips were dumb, in my heart, how I cursed that load. And in the long, long night, by the lone firelight, while the huskies round in a ring, howled their woes to the homeless snows. God, how I loathe the thing. And every day that quiet clay seemed to heavier and heavier grow. And on I went, though the dogs were spent and the grub was running low. The trail was bad and I felt half mad, but I swore I would not give in. And at night I would sing to that hateful thing. Till I came to the marge of Lake LaBarge, and a derelict lay there. It was jammed in the ice, and I saw in a trice it was called the Alice May. I looked at it, I thought a bit, then I looked at my frozen chum, and here, said I with a sudden cry, is my crematorium! Some planks I tore from the cabin floor, and I lit the boiler fire. Some coal I found lying around, and I heaped the fuel higher. The furnace roared, the flames just soared, and the furnace roared. Such a blaze you seldom see. I burrowed a hole in the glowing coals, and I stuffed in Sam McGee. Then I made a hike, for I did not like to hear it sizzle so. And the heavens scowled, and the huskies howled, and the wind began to blow. It was icy cold, but the hot sweat ran down my cheeks, and I don't know why. And then, I had no when I was young. And I made a hike for I did not like to hear him sizzle so. And the hot sweat rolled down my cheeks, I do not know why. And the greasy smoke in an inky cloak went streaking down the sky. I don't know how long I was in the cold snow. But I did something. But I wrestled with grisly fear, and the stars came out and danced about, and I ventured near. I guess I'll just take a peep inside, I said. I guess he's cooked. It's time I looked. And the door I opened wide, and there sat Sam, looking cool and calm in the heart of the furnace roar. And he wore a smile you could see a mile. And he said, please close that door. It's fine in here, but I greatly fear you'll let in the cold and storm. Since I left Plumtree down in Tennessee, it's the first time I've been warm. There are strange things done in the midnight sun by the men who moiled for gold. The Arctic trails have their secret tales that would make your blood run cold. The northern lights have seen queer sights. Queerest they ever did see was that night on the marge of Lake LaBarge. I cremated Sam McGee.
This group of youngsters are always on the go. Practice, practice, practice. Dancing for our enjoyment, the Quail Country Liners, to Rock and Roll Waltz by Scooter Lee, a four-wall dance. Slipped out of my shoes at the door. Then from the front room, I heard a jump tune. I looked in, and here's what I saw. There in the night, what a wonderful scene. Mom was dancing. Thank you so much. How beautiful, how graceful. Without really needing an introduction, this young lady is a favorite of everyone. She has performed worldwide and has followings of thousands. Please welcome our very own Miss Patsy Cline.
I've got the record that we daddy, whoa, whoa. Thank you so much. Okay, now you know we've been brought to my attention. A wee bit of a math problem was given to our friend Bev at school to solve. The problem, Cheryl bought 5 loaves of bread at 25 cents a loaf. She bought beef at the cost of $1.25 a pound. And the only information I want is where does Cheryl shop? You will find all walks of life at a bus stop waiting for buses to arrive. Some folks like to read, some folks like to visit, and some would just rather not be there at all. No matter what, they must take the bus to get to their destination.
Thank you.
Oh, the bus, the bus. Whoa, I tell you, you'd better watch your back when I'm walking. The other day, well, maybe a week or so ago, you know how time flies by, I ran into a very, very strange fellow. Was it last week? Oh, that doesn't matter. Oh, Lordy, here he comes now. Who are you? And what are you doing?
Bud.
Huh?
Bud. You know, Elmo.
Oh, Elmo Fudd. Yeah. I think you must mean Elmer Fudd.
Elmo Fudd.
What are you doing here? There's no rabbits here.
No rabbits, ducks.
Dukes?
Dukes.
Dukes?
Dukes.
Oh my, oh yoy. What do you mean? You mean ducks?
Dukes, yes.
Ah, dukes. Ducks. Say, they sure are flying overhead last week.
Kill the ducks.
We all know how much trouble our Conley likes to get into. Watch out, girls. He's worked writing and rewriting these dance steps just to chase you all around the floor.
Take that on your nose.
Stretch your legs, do whatever you want for maybe 5 minutes. Okay? Hello. A real story time. Talking of troubles, toils and woes, and oh, the throbbing, the throbbing.
No, no. All right, this is gonna be hard to do. So another poem by Robert Service. Jerry did a fine job on the first one. He's got a better memory than I do. So this is called Bessie's Boil. Says I to my missus, by goomlass, you've something to see on your mind. Says she, you're right, Sam. There's something that's on me behind. A boil, as Mudley Jot the Ellis, it hurts me to no end when I sit. Says I, go to the hospital, missus. They might have to cut it a bit. Says she, I hate to be showing the part of me person it's at. Says I, don't be fussy. Then doctors seen sights more horrid than that. So missus, she goes off all togged up tasty, and there at the hospital door, they tell her to see the house doctor, whose office is room 34. So she hunts up and down till she finds it and knocks, and the voice says, come in. And there's a handsome young feller, all white from his heels to his chin. I've got a big boil, says my missus. It hurts me for fair when I sit. And Sam, that's me, her husband, has asked me to ask you to cut it a bit. And blushing, she plucks up her courage, and bravely she shows him the place, and he gives it a proper inspection with a heap of surprise on his face. And he says with an accent of Scotland, well, yeah, it's a boil, I can feel it, but you'd better consult the head doctor. They call him Professor O'Neill. He's special for biles and carbuncles. You'll find him in room 63. No charge, ma'am. It's been a rare pleasure. Just tell him you're coming for me. So missus, she thanks him politely and hunts up and down as before, till she comes to a big handsome room with Professor O'Neill on the door. Then once more she plucks up her courage and knocks, and a voice says, all right. She enters and sees a fat feller with whiskers all togged up in white. So blushing as red, I've got a big boil, says my missus. And if you'll kindly permit, I'd like for to have you inspect it. It hurts me like all when I sit. So blushing as red as a beetroot, she hastens to show him the spot. And he says with a look of amazement, surely, ma'am, that must hurt a lot. Then he puts on his specs to regard it, and finally he says with a frown, I bet it's as sore as a devil, especially when you sit down. I think it's a case for the surgeon. You better consult Dr. Hoyle. I've no hesitation in saying, here, Boyle is a hell of a boy. So Mrs., she thanks him for saying her boil is a hell of a boil and hunts all around till she come on a door that is marked Dr. Hoyle. But by now she's as spark out the window and trembles in every limb. And she thinks after, oh, he's a doctor. I mustn't be bashful with him. She's made of good stuff, is the missus. So she knocks and a voice says, who's there? It's me, says my Bessie, and enters the room, which is spacious and big and bare. And a wise-looking old feller greets her, and two, he's togged up in white. It's a room where they cut you, thinks Bessie, and she shakes like a jelly with fright. I've got a big boil, begins Mrs., and if you're sure you don't mind, I'd like you to see it a moment. It hurts me because it's behind. So thinking she'd best get it over, she hastens to show him the place, and he stares at her kind of surprisedly and gets very red in the face. But he looks at it most conscientious from every angle of view, and he says with a shrug of his shoulders, poor lady, I'm sorry for you. It was to be cut, but you should have a medical blow to do that. Say, why don't you go to the hospital where all the doctors is at? You'll see, ma'am, this part of the building is closed on account of repairs. Us fellows is only the painters, painting the halls and the stairs.
Excuse me. That the end was near. His wife, two sons, and a daughter are with him. He asks for two witnesses to be present and a camcorder in place to make his last will. And when all is ready, he began speaking. My son, Bernie, I chose you to take the Mayfair houses. My daughter, Sybil, you take the apartments over the East End. My son, Jamie, I want you to take the offices over the city center. Sarah, my wife, please take the residential buildings on the bank of the river. The nurse and the witnesses were blown away. The nurse said, Mrs. Smith, your husband must have been such a hardworking man to accomplish all this property. The wife replied, nah, he just covers a lot of ground with his newspaper route. Now have, for your pleasure, toe stomping, eye rolling, hand clapping, down home, snowbird duet.
Anyhow, when we give this little jingle, we'd like everybody to sing this little
sing along.
Sing along to, and it goes like this. My ding-a-ling, my ding-a-ling. Other bought me this little toy. Silver bells hanging on a string. Told me my ding-a-ling, my ding-a-ling. My ding-a-ling, we'll run away with my ding-a-ling. My ding-a-ling, my ding-a-ling, just run away with my ding-a-ling. My mother took me to grammar school. And every time that bell would ring, catch me playing with ding-a-ling, ba-ding-a-ling, ba-ding-a-ling. Just wanna play with my ding-a-ling, ba-ding-a-ling, ba-ding-a-ling. Just wanna play with my ding-a-ling. Ding-a-ling, just wanna play with my ding-a-ling. Once I was swimming across Turtle Creek, many snaps all the road on my feet. Sure was hard swimming across that lake, with both hands holding my ding-a-ling. My ding-a-ling, my ding-a-ling. Just wanna play with my ding-a-ling, my ding-a-ling, my ding-a-ling. Just wanna play with my ding-a-ling. Houston's playhouse on the kitchen floor. She was queen and I was king. Even let her play with my ding-a-ling, my ding-a-ling, my ding-a-ling. I wanna play with my ding-a-ling, my ding-a-ling, my ding-a-ling. I wanna play with my ding-a-ling.
Tell me, why don't you sing?
This here song, it ain't so sad. Cutest little song you ever had. Those of you who went on marching, you must be playing with your ding-a-ling. Your ding-a-ling, your ding-a-ling. Keep playing with your ding-a-ling, my ding-a-ling, my ding-a-ling. I want to play with my ding-a-ling.
Hello, I'm your host, Oscar Wienemeyer. Hot dog, hasn't it been a good show tonight? It has. So, We're going to be taping the Good Morning the Soyuz show here in a while. But right now, you've all been enjoying the pre-entertainment. And I'm glad, are you all from town here? Everybody lives here, nobody from out of province? That's funny, because you know, I was at Tim Hortons for coffee here the other day. There's four guys sitting on a table next to me. And they're just bitching about everything in BC. The premier, the roads, the snow plow, the garbage pickup. And I'm thinking to myself, it's gotta be strange. And I walk out in the parking lot, and sure enough, every car there had an out of province plate on it. But anyway, we're gonna get ready for the show. I gotta go to makeup. And what's that? No. Janice isn't here yet. She got two flat tires on her bike. let me guess, she took a shortcut through Nk'Mip. Well, I guess I'll have to do the makeup myself. I mean, I've sat through it 100 times or more. So here we go.
Putting on my pajamas tonight.
Just trying to save his shirt from all that makeup he's got to use.
All right. So. Well, let's see. Try a little bit of this white, maybe. I like my cheeks. That should look good. I don't know. It'll show up better on the camera. Little purple under the eyes, so they look a little bit more sunken. There. Is it showing up out there? I can't see. I forgot my mirror. Well, Jackie has a mirror. A little bit of orange. Yeah. Just behind, under my ears. Maybe, can you do it on my eyelids? Are my lips showing up good enough?
Them every week for years and years. Ah, yes. Rose has landed her dream job, a producer of a talk show, recruiting Dorothy and Blanche as her first guests, working together with their host and image consultants. I think we really want to see what Dorothy and Blanche have to say.
Beautiful makeup, brother. Jackie still hasn't shown up. But anyway, welcome back to Wake Up with a Soyuz talk show. We have some special guests today. And, I can't even read my notes here. I'm lost. So today we're talking about women who live together. Does society make it harder for them? We'll find out when we come back. Kind of flustered that Jackie didn't show up. So, women who live together, does society make it tougher? We're going to find out when when we talk to poor lesbians after this commercial break. Hang tight.
Rose, could I see you for a moment?
You look mad.
You darn right I'm mad. How did this happen? Like, we thought we were just going to be on a show and, like, normal people?
Well, I don't know. They just said to ask if I knew two people who loved each other and slept together, and I thought of you guys.
We do not sleep together.
Yes, you do. Remember when all the plaster fell off the wall behind Blanche's headboard and they were painting and redoing it? You slept together then.
On the air in 30 seconds, ladies.
I'm not going to do this.
You have to. I'll lose my job. It's my first real job. And anyway, if I don't have a job, all I'll have to do is sit around the house talking about stories about St. Olaf.
Sounds like blackmail to me.
Yes.
Well, please.
Maybe if we don't say anything, the cameras
can't be on. You can do her on in a minute. Go. You guys can do it. You can do it for me.
And we're back. So let's meet our panelists. The young lady here is Dorothy. She's a lesbian. Blanche, another beautiful lady, another lesbian. And over here on the left, we have Pat and Angie, image consultants.
How come they're not called lesbians?
We don't believe in labels.
Well, I have a couple of questions for these two lesbians. Dorothy, do you plan on getting married?
No, I was married to a man once, and I could not train him, so no, never.
Blanche, would you ever consider being with a man again?
Well, I never thought I'd be with a woman, so anything's possible.
So there's a chance for me then? I see we have a question from the audience. Yes, sir.
I'd like to know if there are male, female roles in the relationship.
Well, I'm the little homemaker, if that's what you mean.
I take garbage.
Fascinating. Any other questions? Oh, here we have.
This is directed to Dorothy's lover. Do people treat you differently because you are a lesbian?
Well, most people don't know.
Really? I would have guessed right off. Next question is Dorothy. Did you always know that you were a lesbian?
No. No.
When did you find out you were a lesbian?
I found out recently. Very recently.
Well, that concludes our show for today. Thank you to our panelists for being my guests on Wake Up with Soy's morning show. Let's have a hand for it.
We all know it wouldn't be Maureen without wine glasses.
about?
Fun? I've never been so embarrassed and humiliated my whole life. I thought you were a friend of ours.
Well, I thought you were my friend. That's why I asked you to be on my show.
Well, girls, I think I need a really large glass of wine and a snack. Oh, look, I think we've got some crackers and some pickled herring.
Pickled herring? That reminds me of the Great Herring War, Sable.
The Great Herring War?
Yeah, between the Lindstroms and the Gustafsons.
Oh, that Great Herring War.
Yeah, the Lindstroms and the Gustafsons owned all of the herring rights off the coast of St. Olaf. And everybody thought it was really good if they banded together. But they couldn't decide what to do with it, so that was kind of a bad idea. Like, the Lindstroms, they wanted to pickle all the herring. And the Gustafsons, well, they wanted to train the herring for a circus.
Well, that's understandable. The possibilities are overwhelming.
They are.
Weren't they kind of hard to see riding on the elephants?
Oh, not that kind of circus, silly. Like the one at SeaWorld, you know, but much smaller than that. Well, like a flea circus, but well, not that small, but small, really small.
Rose, you're making this up.
Well, tell me, Rose, did they ever shoot herring out of a cannon?
Yes, they did. Once they shot a herring and it hit a wall, it just smashed all over. It was horrible. There was herring stuff running down the walls and everything. And well, of course, after that, no other herring would get in the cannon.
I don't wonder. But this story seems too far-fetched to be realistic.
Well, it is so true, my grandfather told me, and he wouldn't lie. Of course, he always called me by my sister's name, and, well, you know, sometimes he'd forget, put his underwear on the outside of his pants. So, yeah, I guess he's not that reliable.
Well, considering he came from St. Olaf, I'm not surprised.
It's not a nice thing to say, but not surprising either.
And Rose, I thought we didn't have to listen to these stories after this morning.
Oh, I'm sorry, I forgot. Thank you, folks.
Thank you, ladies.
I ordered some Chinese food the other day from a local restaurant, not mentioning any names. I picked it up and was driving home. I heard a rustling sound, looked over, the bag seemed to be moving. I thought, what on earth is that? Has something gotten into the bags? Then I thought I'd seen eyes peering out. I just had to pull over. I leaned forward, picked up the bags carefully, putting them on the passenger seat, and there it was again, more rustling, and little eyes looking out behind the ginger beef. Thought running through my mind, must be a mouse or a rat. Shaking in my boots, I carefully spread the bag open, just a little. Aw, so cute, it was a Pekin duck. Next we have a story by Beth. Readily available in Oliver. Strips and strips.
Hello.
Oh, no.
Oh, there I am.
I'm just going to tell you a story about ladies. Now, this is back in the 80s. Do you remember when beauty products came out? We all know. We all remember buying them, thinking that they were going to beautify us, because let's face it, this does not come naturally. So one night began as any other night. I came home from work, fixed dinner. Then I had a thought that would ring painfully in my mind for the next couple of hours. Maybe I could use that wax in my medicine cabinet. I set up my son and my husband. I said, go watch a movie. I mean, I know there's that cold wax kit in the bathroom. I'm dying to try that stuff. No melting, a clump of hot wax. You just rub those clear strips in your hand, peel them apart, press it on your leg, or wherever, and ignore the frantically rising crescendo of string instruments in the background. No muss, no fuss. How hard can this be? I mean, I'm not the girliest of girls, but I'm mechanically inclined, so maybe I can figure out how this works. You'd think. If I pull one of those strips out, it's two strips facing each other, stuck together. I'm supposed to rub it in my hand to warm and soften the wax? I'm guessing. I go one better. I pull out the hairdryer and heat that son of a bitch to 10,000 degrees. Cold wax my ass. Oh, how that phrase will come back to haunt me. I lay the strip across my thigh, hold the skin around it, and pull. Ooh, wasn't that bad? Not the best feeling in the world, but wasn't bad. I can do this. Hair removal no longer eludes me. I am Shira, fighter of all wayward body hair and smooth skin extraordinaire. With my next wax strip, I move north. After checking on the guys and verifying that they are in fact ignoring everything that's going on, I sneak into the... sneak into the bathroom again for the ultimate hair fighting championship. I drop my underwear and place one foot on the toilet. Using the same procedure, I then apply this wax strip across the right side of my bikini line, covering the right half of my vagina and stretching right up the inside of that right ass peak. Yeah, it was a long strip. I inhale deeply. I brace myself. Ripped. Hit. I'm blind. Blind from the pain. Vision is returning. Oh, crap. I've managed to pull off half an inch of the strip. Another deep breath. Rip. Everything is swirling. High-dyed vision. Do I hear crashing drums? Oh, okay, coming back to normal again. I want to see my trophy, my wax-covered pelt that caused me so much agony. I want to revel in the glory that is my triumph over body hair. I hold the wax strip up like a gold medal. No, why is there no hair on it? Why is the wax gone? Where did the wax go? Not on the strip. So I ease my head down. My foot is still perched on the toilet. I see hair. That hair should be on the strip. I touch. I feel. I'm touching wax. I look to the ceiling and silently show no! And realize I had just begun living my own personal version of the tar baby. I peel my fingers off the softest, most sensitive part of my body that is now covered in cold wax and matted hair. Make the next big mistake. Up until this point, you'll remember I've had my foot on the toilet. I need to move to do something. So I put my foot down on the floor, and then I hear the slamming of the cell door, vagina sealed shut. Ass sealed shut. A little voice in my head says, I hope you don't have to potty anytime soon. Your head just might pop off. I paint would walk around the bathroom trying desperately to figure out what I should do next. Hot water. Yes, hot water melts wax. I'll run the hottest water I can stand and get in the wax. Should melt. I can gently wipe it away, right? Wrong. I get in the tub. The tub is slightly hotter than is used to torture prisoners of war or sterilize surgical instruments, and I sit. Now, the only thing worse than having your goodies glued together is having them glued and then glued to the bottom of the tub. Scalding hot water. Which, by the way, does not melt wax. So now I'm stuck to the tub. I call my friend Cheryl because she was once a dropout of a beauty school. Surely she has some secret knowledge or trick to get wax off the skin. It's never good to start a conversation with, "So, my nether regions are stuck to the tub." She doesn't have a trick. She does her best to suppress laughter. She wants to know exactly where the wax is on the ass. Are we talking cheek or hole here? She isn't even trying to hide the laughter now. I give her a rundown of the entire night. She tells me to call the number on the side of the box, but to have a good cover story for where that wax actually is. You know, if you were working the helpline at XX Wax Company, and somebody called with their entire crack sealed shut, we just put them on hold and record the conversation for everyone to know. You're going to end up on the radio show or the news. While we go through various solutions, I've resorted to scraping the wax off of the razor. Boy, nothing feels better to the girly goodies than covering them in wax, sticking them to a tub in super hot water, then dry shaving the wax off. In the middle of the conversation, which has inexplicably turned to other subjects, I find the little beautiful saving grace is a lotion provided with the wax to remove the excess. I rub some in and start screaming, "It's working, it's working." I get hearty congratulations from Cheryl and hang up. I successfully remove all the wax and notice to my dismay that the hair is still there. I shaved the damn stuff off. Well, I was numb by that point anyway. And then I put the wax back in the medicine cabinet. You never know when a mustache might come in. Tonight, I'm going to start dyeing my hair.
If I were not part of the Snowbird family, there's something else I would rather be. If I were not part of the Snowbird family, Sergeant Major, me, and this would be my song. Left, right, left, right, left, right, swing those bloody arms. Left, right, left, right, swing those bloody arms. Left.
If I were not a part of the Snowbird family, there is something else I'd rather be. If I were not a part of the Snowbird family, a blackjack dealer, me, happy all day long, and this would be my song. Hit me here, hit me there, 21 or bust. Hit me here, hit me there, 21 or bust. Hit me here.
Left, right, left, right, left, right, swing those bloody arms, left, right.
If I were not part of the Snowbird family, there's something else I'd rather be. If I were not part of the Snowbird family, a tennis player, me, happy all day long. And this would be my song. Balls to you, sir, balls to you, sir, up and down the court. Balls to you, sir, balls to you, sir, up and down the court. Balls to you, sir, balls to you, sir, up and down the court. Balls to you, sir, balls to you, sir, up and down the court.
Left, right, left, right, 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 right.
If I were not a part of the Snowbird family, there's something else I would rather be. if I were not a part of the Snowbird family, a taxi driver, me, happy all day long.
Yeah, right.
And this will be my song. Honk honk here, beep beep there, driving around town. Honk honk here, beep beep there, me driving around town. Honk honk here, beep beep there, driving around town. Honk honk here.
Part of the Snowbird family, something else I'd rather be. While we're not part of the Snowbird family, me, a lighthouse keeper, and this would be my song. And a flash here.
Something else I would rather be if I were not part of the Snowbird family, an undertaker. Happy all day long, and this would be my song. Shut their eyes, lay them out, shove them in a box. Shut their eyes, lay them out, shove them in a box. Shut their eyes, lay them out, shove them in a box. Shut their eyes, lay them out, shove them in a box. Shut their eyes, lay them out, shove them in a box.
Not part of the Snowbird family, there's something else I'd rather be. If I was not part of the Snowbird family, a seamstress me, happy all day long, and this would be my song. Yard, measure by the happy yard and cut it by the inch. Happy yard and cut it by the inch. Snap.
Shut their eyes, lay them out, shove them in the box. Shut their eyes, lay them out, shove them in the box. Shut their eyes, lay them out, shove them in the box.
Ken and Susan, our coordinator. Thank you for so much help, George.